Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Zatarain's, now celebrating their 125th anniversary. From WWNO New Orleans, this is Louisiana Eats. I'm Poppy Tooker. Here in Louisiana, we love to throw a good party. But sometimes the organization and preparation required can be a bit daunting. On this week's show, we've gathered together some entertaining professionals to get you ready for the party season ahead. We'll learn how to custom tailor cocktails for your guests from bartending professional Anthony Caporale. Then, Ryan Chetiyawardana speeds up the mixing efforts with ideas from his London establishment, The White Lion. And of course, those guests are sure to show up hungry. That's where Jennifer Chandler comes in, with quick hors d'oeuvres straight from her southern pantry. It's party time on this week's Louisiana Eats.
My kind of role in the cocktail world sort of underpins everything else that I do. It's definitely the backbone of all the other projects that I'm involved with. My name is Anthony Caporale. I'm the national brand ambassador for Drambuie Scotch Liqueur. I'm also a chef instructor at New York's Institute of Culinary Education and the managing editor of Chilled Magazine.
Anthony Caporale's multifaceted career as bartender, chef, performer, and restaurateur has given him keen insight into the world of entertaining guests and the cocktail industry. Though his resume continues to expand, his passion for hosting keeps him behind the bar.
It's really funny because I actually started as a bartender, as a working bartender, full-time right out of college. I went to school in North Carolina, but I'm from New York, and I have a degree in mechanical engineering, believe it or not. And I wasn't ready to sort of take the plunge into the 9-to-5 engineering world. So I got what was supposed to be just a summer job waiting tables. And luckily, through, you know, no credit that I could take, a position to open up at the bar within the first month, and that never happens. Once I got behind the bar, what was supposed to be a summer job turned into a full-time, year-long job for me. I eventually took it down to part-time in order to pursue engineering and sales and a bunch of other things, but I've never stopped bartending since then. So that's sort of how I started. And then from there, what I realized is that I really enjoy training bartenders. So I started doing that very early on. And that led me to helping people open restaurants. And I was actually lucky enough to be involved with an opening of one of the first major brew pubs in the United States in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, right on Franklin Street, called Top of the Hill Brewery. Mm-hmm. And I just absolutely fell in love with opening restaurants. So I purchased a restaurant myself, opened it, sold it, and then started doing that sort of as my thing. So I think today I have probably about 20, 25 different openings under my belt. And that's really what led me to the Institute of Culinary Education, is teaching other people how to do that.
So what has kept you continuing to tend bar?
It's a great question. I always say that it's the people. You have to love the people and you have to love their reaction. So I always tell people that what we serve at the bar is not the drink. It's not what's in the glass. It's everything around the glass. It's the experience, right? And the company that I always say that really gets this at sort of a core level is Disney. You know, they realize that what they're selling is an experience, and whether they deliver it through movies or Broadway shows or restaurants or a theme park, they understand that people want to have that positive experience. And the thing when I'm training bartenders, what I always try and get across to them is it's not the drink. If you think that bartending is about making drinks, you need to kind of rethink it. It's about serving drinks, and there's a big difference there. And I think, you know, for a little while, we kind of lost track of that with the craft cocktail movement. It was all about, you know, the drinks. How complicated can it be in the glass? How does the drink make me look as a bartender? The industry is sort of over that stage where we were very, very precious, you know, and we're getting back to, how do we make things really high quality without being overly complicated? And those wait times, as you know, they got ridiculous for a while. I mean, it was not uncommon to have to wait 10, 15 minutes for a cocktail. And cocktails, you know, we have a long tradition of cocktails being quick serve. You know, the highball goes back to the fact that we needed a drink before the train left. And so what was the quickest serve we could come up with? And that's where we developed that drink. So, you know, I think it's very presumptuous. And again, it moves away from the experience to take 10, 15 minutes to make a drink. So drinks should not be designed for resumes. They should be designed for menus. They have to be accessible. They have to be able to make the venue money. But most importantly, they have to deliver the experience to the guest. It's not about the bartender. It's about the guest. So that's really what keeps me in the business. I just love that. You know, the reason why that supposedly summer job turned into a year of full-time work is because I felt like I was on the stage. Every time I got behind the bar, I say that it's like, you know, I get to put on a Broadway show every night, but I only had to audition once.
So I am fascinated to talk with you about bottled cocktails because I can tell you that I think here in New Orleans, I don't think that's happening yet. I think that's a relatively new trend. Do you see it as a backlash from waiting 20 minutes to pay $20 for a craft cocktail?
Yes, I think that's exactly what it is. Well, one, I think, you know, bottled cocktails are nothing new. The big companies have been doing them, you know, forever. And if you really want to go back to the definition of a cocktail, which is just a spirit with some sweetener and something to balance it, right? Bitter or sour. Every liqueur you've ever had, including Drambuie, which is the one that I work for, they were originally developed essentially with that formula in mind. So as far back as 1745, when Drambuie, you know, was first developed, the day they put it in a bottle, that was a bottled cocktail.
Yeah.
So what we've done is we've sort of moved away from that into the, you know, the more modern era where people started then opening these bottles and making drinks with them and combining them in new ways in the glass. So I think what we're finding now is that the bartenders now are taking ownership of this bottling trend and taking their creations and bottling them and not just leaving it to the Bacardis of the world with their premix, you know, whatever, again, is out there in the world. Everything old is new again. But I think the reason the bartenders are embracing it and the restaurants are embracing it is exactly what you said. It's a way to create very high quality cocktails. You can get as complicated as you want. You can take as much time as you want with that recipe. But again, it's done backstage. Mm-hmm. It's done before the guest arrives.
It's batching, which is so common.
Thank you. That's exactly. And that's how we in the industry always serve cocktails when we do large events.
Well, another trend. I have to tell you, I know nothing about draft cocktails. So would you tell me about that?
Yeah, absolutely. So this is an extension, again, of exactly the point you brought up. To be able to serve the highest quality drinks without making the guest have to wait. What you do with draft cocktails is you batch them. I can take an hour getting that recipe perfect before I open the doors. Once I have it, I put it in a soda keg. Now, what helped really a lot with the draft cocktail movement is, believe it or not, the homebrew industry. Because now, being able to brew beer at home and serve it on draft is very easy because for the last 15 years, there's been a demand for that among the homebrewers. So we know how to take a soda keg, what we call a soda keg. It's about a 5-gallon keg. We know how to hook that up with a regulator and a CO2 cylinder and a small draft handle. And we've been doing that for a long time. It's very easy now to just put cocktails in that keg. Those kegs are designed to open easily, be filled easily, and be cleaned easily. So this is where this is coming from. So even a bar that's a very small mom-and-pop bar can very inexpensively, with a minimum amount of effort, serve draft cocktails. And boy, isn't that some bling factor?
Yeah, it is.
It's really cool.
It's real impressive.
Yeah. And you want to take 20 minutes making that recipe perfect? Go ahead and do it. But when I ask for it, you serve it to me as quickly as you can serve me a draft beer. And that's one of the fastest serves we have in the industry.
That's very interesting. And, you know, of course, one of the companies that you work really closely with right now is Drambuie. For those who might be like me and maybe even turn their nose up at Drambuie because of its relation to Scotch, tell us a little bit about the history of Drambuie and how you see its place fitting on the bar shelf.
You know, the beautiful thing about Drambuie and where it fits in today is that we really, you know, the craft cocktail movement is really all about rediscovering the origin of cocktails, the roots of spirits, and reconnecting the historical significance of spirits and cocktails with enjoying them. And unfortunately, Prohibition sort of disconnected those two. Mm-hmm. Actually, what you find is that Prohibition really took alcohol and focused our attention on alcohol as an intoxicant only. When you go before that, you realize it played a much greater role in our culture. And without it, we probably would never have been able to evolve because there were no municipal water supplies. There were no water treatment plants. And as I mentioned, alcohol is a preservative. And when you add it to polluted water, it becomes potable. Mm-hmm. So that was one of the main things that we used it for. And that's one of the things that, you know, Drambuie back in 1745, when it was originally developed, was because the spirits at that time, we didn't have accurate thermometers. We didn't have chemistry. The spirits were inconsistent. And they didn't taste very good, but we had to drink them for the reasons that I just discussed. So to be able to take a Scotch whiskey that didn't taste that great and make it taste consistently good by adding the Drambuie elixir, which was things like heather honey, baking spices, clove, nutmeg, was a fantastically valuable thing. Okay, so we have this great historical significance. We have, you know, this terrific story. Then we fast forward to the 1950s and we developed the rusty nail. And I love the story of how that came to be, because if you think about it, so we have now Scotch that now tastes good. It's 1950. We know science. So Drambuie is a little sweet for some people. We don't need quite as much fixing of the whiskey as we did in 1745. But you can't take the spices and the honey out. You can dilute them, though. So a rusty nail, for those of you listeners who might not know the recipe, is just Drambuie, which is a Scotch liqueur. Drambuie is a blended Scotch, like Dewar's or Johnny Walker Red, that has the Drambuie elixir added, heather, honey, and spices. If I know that and I want to make it less sweet, I simply add more Scotch. Mm-hmm. And that's the point of the rusty nail. So there's a reason it's a classic. It's one of the most versatile drinks out there. And I actually like to do what I call rusty nail fittings with my guests.
What is that? How would you fit me for a rusty nail, Anthony?
First thing I would have you do is tell me how sweet you like things. I might make you taste a couple things. I might make you taste a glass of cola. I might make you taste a glass of orange juice. Ask you other things you drink. So then I'm going to know how much Drambuie relative to Scotch I can add. If you like things really sweet, it'll be mostly Drambuie with a drop of Scotch. If you like things very dry, not sweet, I'm going to do mostly Scotch, but a drop of Drambuie. Right there, I have an almost infinite spectrum where I can make you a custom rusty nail. But the cool thing is, what kind of Scotch do you like?
I don't know.
So that's what we would spend the most of the night on. I would taste you through several single malts. Do you like something that's maybe a little softer, maybe like a lowland single malt? Do you like something that's got a little bit more smoke and peat, like an Islay? That's my favorite. Do you like a blended Scotch? Where do you fit on that? And then I go to my Scotch shelf. And now I have two variables that I can dial in. I can pick your perfect Scotch and the perfect ratio of Scotch and Drambuie, and I can literally custom fit your rusty nail.
Award-winning bartender Brian Kientz directs the action at America's oldest stand-up bar, a Toujek's restaurant in the French Quarter. When Brian's family gathers at holiday time, their tradition is to toast each other with something they call It's a Wonderful Life Punch. It's not very crafty, but it's easy to prepare in advance, and Brian says everyone asks for the recipe. Although everything these days seems to center around fresh ingredients, Brian warns not to be tempted to use fresh juice. It may sound crazy, but the juice concentrates he uses enhance the flavor and texture perfectly. The punch should be made at least 24 hours in advance so that it will become properly slushy. I think it's a good idea to keep a batch ready in the freezer for unexpected guests or any time you need a little holiday lift. First, brew 2.5 cups of black tea and cool it to room temperature. In a large, freezer-proof bowl, combine the tea with 1 can of frozen lemonade and 1 can of frozen orange juice, each thawed. Stir in 1 cup of sugar, 6 cups of water, and 2 generous cups of spiced bourbon or rum. Brian likes to use Wild Turkey Spiced Bourbon or Old New Orleans Spiced Rum. Cover the punch tightly and store in the freezer overnight to get your bourbon-infused slushy goodness on. Take it out of the freezer 1 hour before serving, or spoon it into 1 cup for a boozy dessert. for a copy of this recipe, visit our website at itsneworleans.com or wwno.org. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. When we come back, cookbook author Jennifer Chandler takes us into her southern pantry, where she can produce a party in minutes just with what's on hand. Stay tuned. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen and Zatarain.
Well, you know, I always say I did go to culinary school, and I've worked in the restaurant business for many, many years. But when it all comes down to it, I'm a mom, and I'm a busy mom, and I have to put dinner on the table for my family. And I joke, but I selfishly wrote this book, and I've written all my books for myself because I needed ways that I could put a home-cooked meal on the table quickly and easily for my family. And the key thing here is it had to be delicious and it had to be good. So that's what these recipes are all about. They're my strategies and my go-tos on putting dinner on the table for my family.
Jennifer Chandler's story could be your own. Her days are long, and by the end of them, she'd love nothing more than to do right by her family. But with only so many hours in the day, it's a challenge to make sure they're getting a nutritious meal. Her new book, The Southern Pantry, focuses on connecting her Southern roots with today's fast-paced life.
When I think about the South and I think about, you know, dishes that are really iconic for here, I mean, certain things come to mind. Grits, for example. I lived in D.C. for 10 years. I went to college up there and then I lived there afterwards. And I remember when I first got there, I couldn't find grits. Or I would even mention that people would say, "What is a grit?" And I'm like, "It is grits." So things like grits, things like okra. For me, more than anything, I think it's just that idea of slowing down and making your meal. So I think that as far as what's in your pantry, there are a few ingredients like that okra, like those grits, that are going to make a little bit of difference than what's up north. And I think when you think about dishes from the north or the south or the west, a lot of these dishes have their roots in what was grown locally. I mean, now today you can go and find an avocado in the grocery store, but you know, 50 years ago, you in the South were not going to find an avocado in the grocery store because they weren't grown anywhere around here. And so things like rice. Rice is grown here in the South, in Louisiana and in Arkansas. And then you think about, you know, a lot of the vegetables like tomatoes. Tomatoes are in a lot of Creole dishes because tomatoes were plentiful here and they were grown here. They're not going to be on the menu as much way up in Maine because, you know, the growing season there is not as long as it is here in the South.
Those were rare tomatoes in Maine. That's the truth. So take us into your personal pantry.
Okay.
What would we find there?
In my pantry, you're always going to find key ingredients that I can use to whip up a meal at any time. There's a certain list of things that you have to have on hand. You have to have a good fat, for example. I mean, I use butter and I use olive oil. Those are the two that are always in my kitchen. I always have frozen vegetables in my freezer because, you know what? You can always whip up something on hand. I keep a frozen bag of shrimp in there, too, because that's the quick way to have a 30-minute supper. I have all of these things that are shelf stable so that I can whip up things. And then I've also got the fresh ingredients. For me, I think this comes from my New Orleans influence. I always have the Holy Trinity in there. I have some onions, I have some celery, and I have some bell pepper, and I have some, well, I throw garlic in there too. So I guess it's no longer a Trinity when you add that extra ingredient. But I have those four things always available because they're the base of so many dishes. But for me, the pantry means the whole kitchen. So in my book, I talk about how what you need to have on your freezer. To have on hand in your freezer. I talk about what you need to have in your refrigerator. I talked about what you need to have on those shelves, whether you have the luxury of having a large kitchen where you actually have a cabinet that you can go into or a room that you can go into, or whether it is you have just a few little shelves that you need to have those few basic ingredients on hand, no matter what size your kitchen is.
So now that we're all stocked up in the refrigerator, in the freezer, in the pantry, and you're set, share with us some of your super quick dinner tips.
Well, I always tell people that you have to have a repertoire in your mind of things that you know that you can make in 30 minutes or less. Now, not every dish can be made that way, but have those in your mind. And then also have dishes that you know that you can kind of get ahead on, so that you know that if you are cooking that week and you know several dishes have chopped onions in it, that first night, chop a whole bunch of onions and put them in little Ziploc bags or in Tupperware containers in your fridge, and then the prep work is already done for you. And also, don't be afraid to take shortcuts. I mean, I'll be the first one to say a homemade chicken stock is always best. However, don't feel bad about picking up a box of pre-made stock at your local market, because you know what? If a shortcut can help you get a homemade meal on the table, that is so much better than driving through a drive-thru.
I am all about the boxed stocks. And in my pantry, not only will you find boxed chicken stock, but oh, what a luxury boxed veal stock is, huh?
Yes, that definitely adds that extra touch to a dish.
It really does oomph it up. Okay, tell me. Dinners. I want to hear about some of these quick dinners.
Well, one of the ones I love to do is shrimp Creole. And I always assumed that shrimp Creole was very difficult to do. And I kind of took a recipe and made it even simpler using canned tomatoes. And this is a 30-minute supper I go to. And when we talk about shrimp, and I know a lot of people here listening in Louisiana have the luxury of beautiful shrimp. And so they never need to use frozen shrimp. But you know what? There are some good frozen shrimp products out there. I keep it in the freezer and I thaw it out. And what I do is I season my shrimp a little bit with a little bit of Cajun seasoning and I saute it just so they're lightly browned. I don't want to cook them too much because I don't want them to be chewy. And then I take them out of the pot and then I saute some onions, bell pepper, a little garlic, a little celery till it's soft. And then I add a can of whole tomatoes in there. And then I let that simmer down to make a nice sauce, and I add a little thyme to it for a little seasoning, salt and pepper. And then once that simmered down for about 20 minutes and made a nice, lovely sauce, I add my shrimp back in, and I stir it all together, and then I serve it over a bowl of rice.
Done.
My kids love it, and it's so simple to do. And for me, when I was pregnant with my first child and right after I had her, a friend of mine brought me one of these huge mason jars full of her vegetable soup with a side of cornbread. And it was just wonderful and it was nourishing, especially when you're, you know, when you're bringing meals to people. A lot of people will bring pasta dishes and it kind of gets to be the same old thing. And there was something about that soup that was so special. So I always include a soup chapter in my books. And one of them in here that I just have to tell you about is my freezer veggie soup. This is just a really classic one that shows kind of some of the flavorful dishes that are in my book. But it's so simple. It is frozen vegetables. It has frozen okra for that southern twist. It has a can of cannelloni beans in it, so it adds the protein. It has a can of tomatoes, and it also has some box stock. And you mix that all together, and you can add some herbs to it and let it simmer for 20 minutes, and you have one of the best and easiest vegetable soups, and it makes a great gift.
Well, I am so glad to have this opportunity to have introduced you to our Louisiana Eats listening audience. And I do hope you'll come back and give us more Jennifer Chandler wisdom again and again.
Well, thanks for having me. I would love to come back and share some of my secrets and my recipes from my kitchen in hopes that it makes people have dinner more simply.
Jennifer Chandler calls Memphis, Tennessee home. Her latest book, The Southern Pantry Cookbook, can be found in bookstores everywhere. Maybe it's just me, but it seems like every year I get invited to holiday parties, and then I get nervous about showing up empty-handed. The hosts of these parties usually overplan and insist that I shouldn't bring anything. But I can't help it. My go-to gesture of goodwill is to pack along a bottle of wine for the host and casually place it on the countertop. That takes the pressure off me and ensures the party will keep going. When I need wine advice, I turn to Bryan Burkey of the Wine Institute of New Orleans.
I want to kind of back up a little bit and talk about what you just said. You're going to bring a gift to the host. And it doesn't really matter what it is or how you arrived at it. It's a gift for the host. And you should really take a lot of pressure off yourself about that. Because believe me, being in the wine business, people are freaked to try to give you a bottle of wine. I think the best way to approach this is to have some connection to the wine yourself. Don't worry about making their connection and having some inside knowledge about what they like. Instead, pick a wine, maybe the wine you had on your honeymoon, maybe the first wine that got you excited about wine, just as simple as a wine you really like. This is one of my favorite wines. Bang. You just hit a home run.
When it comes to wines, unless someone is very well schooled in wine, or it's a particularly inexpensive label that somebody could recognize, the gift of wine is almost what they call in the retail world blind, because so often you're not really sure what the value of the bottle of wine is.
Oh, absolutely. Which actually, you just described why I started to study wine. My father-in-law is very generous. He's a fantastic man and loves great tastes, and introduced me to very expensive wines, to which I was very appreciative of, but could not ever afford if he wasn't around. and would go into wine shops and go, wow, that bottle's 80 and that bottle's 8. Why? You know, and had no idea why. Had no idea why. And I was very intimidated to talk to people. I said, I'm going to go find out, and read lots of books. And this is now many years and a long journey away. But that was really the impetus. I wanted to know what the magic was between these things that you couldn't see any difference of. Everyone likes really sort of generic things. You know, it's like, oh, I like that. Does anybody love that sort of generic thing? Well, no, maybe they don't have a passion for it. And instead, it's that specific thing. It's that particular thing that you have that great passion for. And fine wines become like that because they're not like anything else. They have their own very distinct personality, and that's kind of what you're paying for. And less expensive wine, there's a lot more of it. It's a lot more general. It's not very specific. It's sort of like one wine is very like the other wine, and thus the price is not pushed up.
What is your favorite wine to bring to a party?
My favorite wine to bring to a party is sparkling wine. It says celebration. And, you know, it's really the one wine that kind of opens with a pop, you know. If I do tell you, that, I mean, there's the Schaffenberger, which is a California sparkling wine, should retail around $15 a bottle, made from Chardonnay, Pinot Noir, the exact process of champagne. Doesn't quite taste like champagne when you have it next to next, but very, very good. And I drink it a lot. There's another one from Argentina that I actually know is hard to get. It's called Toso, T-O-S-O. They do some particular things that are very nice. It's also around $15. So some come and go. I can think of three or four that I can get for 3 weeks, and then I can't get for 2 months, and then I can get them for a week. So I would tell people who are hung up on a brand or a specific thing to ask for help, ask for something similar, and try it. You might like it better. It's highly unlikely that you will like it less.
How about some disasters? Do you have any terrible no-nos of what not to do?
My terrible no-nos on what not to do are actually with the receiver of the gift and not the giver. Time and time again, someone is given a very nice bottle of wine and they never drink it. They are in somehow just in fear. I mean, I've talked to people who've inherited these bottles. Well, this was given to my parents who never really did wine, and they were afraid to open it. I was like, oh my God, that's just a tragedy. First of all, the wine is not any good anymore because it's been 30 years, but it's an experience that they should have had. You know, it was an experience that was being given to them. So to not open them thinking that maybe their special moment will once upon a time happen, that special moment is going to be next Friday night. That is going to be when that next special moment is going to be.
When the tables are turned and I'm hosting the party, I like to serve a little digestif after dinner. I'm a big fan of ports, but Brian's got all sorts of advice for dessert wines.
Well, two or three major ways to look at dessert wine are going to be what we call late harvest and botrytis. Botrytis is a mold that gets on the grapes and helps to concentrate the sweetness and the acidity. And that has its own flavor. So it distinguishes itself from just a late harvest wine where the grapes are just really, really sweet.
That mold, that's what they call the noble rot, right?
That's right. Yeah, that's right. That's a better, well, botrytis doesn't sound too bad, but noble rot, I don't know, that doesn't sound so good either, actually. I
mean, where did that come from?
Well, it's mostly noted to have been discovered in the village of Sauternes in Bordeaux during, you know, tumultuous times. Some Visigoths or something came through the village and everybody ran for the hills. And by the time these warriors had left and pillaged and done everything, their destruction, the villagers and the farmers and the vineyards came back, this mold had taken over their grapes. And they said, well, whatever, it's all done for this year, so let's just see what we have. And they ended up with this gorgeous, beautiful, world-renowned Sauternes that we have today. And they say it was an accident.
So how does port fit into all of this mix?
Okay, port becomes sort of our third style, and sherry falls into this to some degree too. So the first two groups of wine we were talking about are wines where we're talking about naturally high concentrated sugar, so that when we add fermentation, we start to convert sugar to alcohol, we still have lots of sugar left over. Ports and sherries don't start with necessarily extra high sugar. They just start with just average sugar amounts that you'd make any kind of wine. But what is done is they're fortified. Alcohol kills yeast. So as only 3, 4, 5% of the sugar has been converted to alcohol in the grape juice, we add a whole bunch, 12% alcohol by volume, and kill all the yeast, thus leaving all that sugar in the wine.
Where do the ports come from that you prefer?
I'm old school, and I believe port means port, Portugal, the Douro region of Portugal. It's one of those generic names still left that in the United States, by law, you can stick port on California grapes. I like fortified wines from California. They're not port, though, in my old school book. So port comes from Portugal.
I'm an old-fashioned girl, and I agree with you. So I love fruit and cheese paired with dessert wines to end a meal. That's the way I like to have dessert a lot. But if you're serving a traditional pecan pie or a d'auberge cake, how does dessert wine fit into that?
Oh, it can fit in beautifully. The pecan pie, very rich, very gooey, lots of brown sugar and cloves. We could go to Hungary and get a tokaj, which has got all sorts of cloves and burnt orange flavors, and it would pair fabulously. Also very sweet. That's the thing with a d'auberge cake, with a pies, things like that. You're going to want to make sure those dessert wines are very sweet. Not all are sweet. So ask your at your wine shop or wherever you're going to get your wine that you do want a very sweet one to go with a very sweet dessert.
What if the whole bottle doesn't get consumed at the end of that meal? How do you store dessert wines, and how long can you expect them to last?
Just as we were saying, there's all these different styles, and again, they come in different degrees of sweetness. The really sweet ones, sugar is a preservative. Think jams. Think you got a jar of jam in your refrigerator? You're not worried about it going bad. It's got all that sugar in it. It's the same thing. That wine's got all that sugar. You can easily get 2 weeks. There may be some people shuddering when I say that. That could be the outside. A week, absolutely.
Well, this is so much good advice. I want to thank you so much for coming to talk with us at Louisiana Eats, Brian.
Oh, thank you.
Brian Burkey of the Wine Institute of New Orleans. How do you ensure the food on your holiday buffet stays safe for your guests to enjoy? Stay tuned, and we'll answer that question when we come right back. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Rouse's Markets.
here's this week's culinary quiz question, brought to you with support from Popeye's Louisiana Culinary Institute. How do you ensure the food on your holiday buffet stays safe for your guests to enjoy? There's lots of tips to ensure food safety at parties. Make small platters of food, keeping the extras in the refrigerator. Then, replace empty platters instead of refilling them. Cold food should only sit on the buffet for 2 hours. After that, you run the risk of contamination. Nest your serving bowls in bowls of ice to keep things chilly. Keep hot food in an oven set to 250 degrees, and then, when you put it out, use chafing dishes or warming trays to keep the hot food at a minimum of 140 degrees. And as simplistic as it seems, keep washing your hands. And when in doubt, throw it out. A trip to the emergency room for food poisoning will really ruin your holidays. Be safe and have fun. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. Ryan Chetiyawardana's name might be hard to pronounce, but the brilliant young Brit is already a legend in the international cocktail community. Ryan has twice won the title of UK Bartender of the Year before opening White Lion in London in 2013, where he's really shaking things up, and not with a cocktail shaker. At White Lion, you can't order a gin and tonic because Mr. Lion, as Ryan is known, has everything batched and ready to go. So how did Ryan Chetiyawardana become Mr. Lion?
Well, it was a childhood nickname, actually. So when we were kids, I think it was just, you know, Ryan Lion. It became very easy for people. So, you know, it became kind of adulterated into that. But when I was working on different projects, it was difficult having a name that's very long, very unpronounceable. You see it on a page and it looks daunting.
Yes, it does.
So when we came to trying to jumping across different projects, Mr. Lion as a moniker became much easier.
Though he has a renowned reputation as a bartender, Mr. Lion is best known for innovation, and he's got the education to back that up. He studied biology and philosophy in school before deciding to become a chef.
Well, it was actually partly through suggestion, partly quite organically. So the chefing side was before I was heading down to art college. I just, you know, we grew up in a food that was, you know, food was so important to us. You know, it was a big part of our family life growing up, and it was something I wanted to take on a bit more of the professional knowledge, so went enrolled to train as a chef. But it was quite quickly, there was bits of it I loved. You know, I'd been studying biology, so a lot of the kind of the practical food science stuff was easily applicable to me. The professional knowledge, the skill set, kind of learning all those things was incredible. But it became quickly apparent to me that it was very alien towards the way I cooked. You know, I loved having people in my house, having people around, cooking for them, knowing what they liked, being able to just chat to them at the same time. So it was my best friend, he just recommended, he said, you know, you could do a switch to the bar. You're still working with flavors, food. Well, you know, same idea, but you get to chat to people and get to, you know, tailor things to people's tastes much more in the way that I saw food. So didn't look back from there.
Well, it was really a smart move for you because you've won many awards since you began your career behind the bar, including UK Bartender of the Year.
Yeah, I was very fortunate with a couple of them. I was actually lucky enough to take that twice, different years and very different kind of scenarios, different competitions. But it was, I was very fortunate. I had interest in both science and arts, and it was an opportunity to kind of fuse those two. So I think it became I think what I was creating within the industry was a little different, and I was learning off incredible people, and it was just well-timed with a lot of things, I think.
Earlier this year, you were named Innovator of the Year by Imbibe magazine.
That's right.
And I'm fascinated that now you're setting out to really turn the cocktail world as we know it on its ear with your new business, White Lion, LYAN. And tell us about how you're shaking things up without using a cocktail shaker.
it's in fact, it's shaking things up without using anything that's usually found in a cocktail bar. And it was, yeah, it's been a real kind of labor of love, that project has been. It's an idea I had about 3 years ago now. And it was done as a means of, you know, I love this industry. I love all the things that go on, all the different approaches to how to put together a cocktail. But it was, you know, it was partly that I was intrigued to see where there are other ways of putting together a cocktail. And thankfully there are. It's, you know, what we've tried to do is take away some of the best parts of a bar. And to me, that was the ability a bar has and a cocktail has to kind of lift your mood. You know, we set up a bar that was very much aimed at allowing us to do what I see as the kind of real crux of bartending, and that's hosting people.
Yes.
So it's, you know, by, you know, there is the aspect of what we've done to the drink side, but the real kind of focus was looking after people. You know, a lot of my friends aren't in the industry, and so they were, you know, they were put off by cocktails. Sometimes they felt that the bars were, you know, a little elitist. A lot of the time that they felt that, you know, there'd be a big wait on a cocktail. They'd wait 20 minutes for a drink and it'd cost them $20. And they would be, you know, it wouldn't match that expectation. So what we wanted to do was flip that on its head. So allow us to really spend time with people, take away a lot of their, you know, their preconceptions of everything about a cocktail bar, take away a lot of their fallbacks at the same time. So you can't come in and order just a gin and tonic.
Yes.
Although I love a gin and tonic, it was fun to kind of get people to start to look at their drinks differently. So we try and spend time with them, find out what they need that drink to do for them. And then we try and match that with one of our drinks. And given the nature of the way we put together the drinks, we can serve them very quickly. Even when we're four deep at the bar, we think we can get a drink out in a good kind of 10 or 20 seconds.
Because you're batching everything.
That's correct, yeah. So it's like a kitchen. So, you know, I always say that if you, and from my background, I know this, you know, no chef makes your food on the spot. It would take you hours to dine in a restaurant if you want, you know, everything was made a la minute. So we take the same principle. We prepare things ahead of time, which actually allows us, you know, from our side, which is very much on our side, is we can be really geeky about all the details. We start with our water, literally at the starting point. So we filter it, remineralize it, use that to make our spirits, so we control it at that stage. We make all the cordials, the distillates, or we get people to make it. If we can't make it the best that we would like, we partner with people. And we control all the drinks behind the scenes, set it up like a kitchen. So when it comes to service, we're just finishing drinks. So there'll be there's a sense of theater still. There's that final flourish, but you're not waiting long on the drink. So all of the balance is in place already. So the drinks are always consistent as well, so nobody has to worry about it being served different from a different bartender. But they come out very quick. And by all the work we put in to kind of bring everything in-house, we save a lot of money. So
of
we
course.
Can pass that saving on, in fact. So our drinks, we hope, are very well priced as well.
I can't resist asking you this question because, you know, we have all been inundated with ice education over the last few years. So what's your position on that, Ryan?
Well, I think it's great. It's one of the things that has been shown about the way people have moved with the industry and how these things have become a conversation is how that professionalism has lifted. So people aren't just now happy enough to go, right, I'm going to use hotel ice that's chipped and wet and small to make my craft cocktail. They're looking at every one of those elements, and the strength lies in the weakest link in the chain.
Yes.
And so if your ice is terrible, your drink's going to be terrible. It's a kind of integral part of the drink. So as long as people are focusing on that, I think it's really important. And it's something that, you know, I'm using ice in other projects, and I'm just trying to be wary of how I use that ingredient because it's a key ingredient. It's really nice that once we opened White Lion, it stimulated a discussion. It's forced people to look at their product and say, you know, fine, we're not going to do what White Lion does and take away these things. We're still using ice and citrus, but are we using it in the best way possible? And it's been amazing to see people use different acidulants, different uses of their lemons, using their lemons more instead of just squeezing them and throwing them in the bin. It's been, you know, one of the big things that we've kickstarted, hopefully, is a conversation about waste.
Yes.
And so how people use a lot of these ingredients in a more conscientious manner.
Yeah, that's fascinating because there's no citrus. There's no wedge of lime in the glass. There's none of that at White Lion.
That's correct. Yeah, there's, you know, and it was something that was constant frustration for me. You know, I've worked in some bars that I'm super proud of and super, like, excited by still, but you'd be squeezing fresh lemons and you'd be throwing away a bin bag full, like a heavy bag full of just lemon husks. And there's still flavor in those things. You
yes.
know, you've paid a lot of money to ship them across the world. I think it's a shame that you just throw half of it away. And partly that was partly a frustration on it because you can recreate like lemon. If we want to at White Lion, we can recreate a lemon. We use it in one ingredient that we call it a turbocharged lemon, where using a blend of different acids, distillates, and sugars, we create a lemon that's almost amplified in flavor. But that wasn't the motivation for us. It wasn't saying how we could cheat a lemon. It was more that, you know, I didn't want to just be throwing things away and using things that were constantly changed depending on where they came from in the world. It was, you know, it was important to me to use ingredients that, you know, particularly in the UK, actually, to go back to the citrus, it was difficult to get good citrus fruit.
Yeah.
So it'd be from India one time, Mexico the next, and, you know, the flavor would change, the pH would change, the oils, all of these things would be hugely different, and yet everybody would follow the same recipe. And that seemed odd to me, whereas if you could create something that was consistent, you could then put together a drink that you were proud of and putting out, and you could serve in a kind of in a regular manner. But it, again, it's not that I'm against lemons. It's just, I think if you're using an ingredient like that, that is natural, embrace the fact that it's natural. It's a fantastic thing. It's got, you know, it's got its own nuances, and you should be able to play up to that and use it in a way that uses all the characteristics of the fruit rather than just going, it's a lemon and I'm going to throw it into my drink.
Well, I'm curious, with all of the arduous training and the posturing of the craft bar chef, what is the reaction from your peers?
We were worried about that at first, actually. We weren't sure that people would rebel against and, well, actually misread why we were doing what we were doing. And thankfully, actually, once people came into the bar, it was very different. I think before we actually opened the doors, people had formed in their mind what the bar was or wasn't about. And it was really nice that actually people were very quick to, you know, swallow that. Once they came in, they were, you know, they saw that it was done for the right reasons. We were there to look after people and just give people a good time and offer drinks that we thought were of the highest quality. So it wasn't about kind of taking anything away and diminishing the cocktail craft. It was offering something different. And we're still very much a promoter of everything around us. The people who are doing things with passion and for the right reasons, we, you know, we send our customers down to them. It's a different experience to what we offer, and we think that's really important.
That's really fascinating. So since you're turning the cocktail industry on its ear right now with your new way of doing cocktails, do you maybe have a glimpse into what might be coming next?
It's easier to answer from a personal perspective. I'm always fascinated what's coming from around the world, and hopefully some of the stuff we've done is going to kickstart people to look at a few other different projects than there is out there. But from my perspective, in terms of where I'm pushing the company, is, you know, for the last few years I've had about 6 or 7 different bar concepts in my head that I think I would love to bring to fruition in and around the reasonable timing of now. So I think it's very important that you fit within the timing of the wider landscape. I mean, you know, it's some of the ideas I have now, when the opportunity comes, they may no longer be relevant. You know, I constantly want to feel inspired by what we're doing. So I never want to rest on our laurels or feel like we're sitting still with anything. Everything will continue to evolve. So White Lion will still continue to evolve as well. I don't think it will ever be that, you know, we're never going to change. It's not that we're going to revert the concept. I'm very proud of that. But we'll continue to add new things to it and build it up in a way that we think is taking it in the right way.
That's fantastic. Well, I want to thank you so much for bringing your inspiring story of innovation and creation to Louisiana Eats. So thank you, Ryan.
Pleasure. Thank you so much for having me.
Bartender and innovator, Ryan Chetiyawardana. That's it for this week's edition of Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Next week, we meet both of Cal Peternell's families, his wife and sons, and his Chez Panisse family, where he's been Alice Waters' chef for 20 years.
I knew right away I had made the right decision because they agreed to hire me about 3 weeks before my son was due to be born, my second son, Milo. And, you know, I said, well, are you sure you want, we can just wait because I'm going to need to have time off. And if you want to just wait, you know, in a month or something and hire me then. And they said, oh, no, don't worry about it. We'll give you the time away after your son's born.
Subscribe to our podcast, hear today's show, or catch up on previous editions anytime online at itsneworleans.com.
Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Rouse's Markets, and Zatarain's. Additional support for Louisiana Eats is provided by Dickie Brennan and Company and Linda Green, the Yakima Lady Soul Food Catering. Our media sponsor is Louisiana Life Magazine, the magazine of a great state. Original theme music by Johnny Sketch and the Dirty Notes. Thanks to executive producer Thomas Walsh and sound engineer Joe Schreiner. I'm Poppy Tooker. We'll see you next time. Louisiana Eats is a production of WWNO and the University of New Orleans.